Here you can create a team or join a team using a link or ID something. This is called the data panel, where all the projects will be displayed, and you can create a new project by clicking this new project button. And you can pin the projects, like there's a pin option available, so it will be pinned. You can also unpin here. I will open this project now. Here you can create a new folder by clicking a new folder icon. You can rename accordingly. Okay. This is the data panel. In the people, you can add people using their email IDs. Then click a invite, so the people will be joined to this group. Toolbar. In this icon, you can change the workspace, like from the design to the generative designing, rendering, animation workspace, simulation workspace, and manufacturing and drawing workspace, so on. Using this markers present in this side, and this home button is used to set the home view. It will be clear while starting the modeling. Now there's nothing in the screen, so and this is the browser where the details about the models and the bodies and the components will be present in the browser. And this is the comment where you can add the comment at the different stage in the model. And look at and pan, zoom in, zoom out, display settings, grid and snap options will be using this option. Is it the cursor in the timeline? Okay. This white space is called canvas where we model. Now I will start with the 2D sketching. To create a sketch, first need to create a create sketch. Then we need to select the plane which we are going to, in which we are going to make a drawing. So for now I will select this plane. Now there will be the different options. Now just snap off on any point needed. Now you can adjust the length using a tab key, like whatever length you can edit here, for example 50. To change the angle, just press a tab key.
Ashwin, excuse me, I think there is some problem with your mic. Your voice is like very low.
Okay. Hello.
Yeah.
For example, 50 for the angle. Press tab and mention the angle, like for example 30. Yeah. Like this we can define the line. Now it turned into the black color. It means the line is fully constrained. In rectangle, there are three types of rectangle. And the shortcut for the two-point rectangle is R. You can press R in the keyboard. You can also select from here itself, like if you need a rectangle, two-point rectangle. You need to specify the length and the width of the rectangle, for example, like 100. Then tap to switch it to the breadth. Okay. Coming to three-point rectangle, we need to specify 3 points. 1 point. Another. Next one, unique where you can use. The other option is the center point rectangle. Here the first we need to select the center point where the rectangle is required. Recommended. I selected the center point. Now I need to specify the breadth, length and the width similarly. 100 cross. In the arc, same way there are three options like 3 point arc, center point arc and tangent arc. 1 point. Again, 2 point. You can specify some distance, 100. Now the 3. You can specify whatever you want. After that, if you need any changes, you can also edit the dimension accordingly. If you require 100, like 100. Then coming to the polygon, we need to specify the radius of the circle and the number of sides. For example, for the pentagon, 5 sides, and the radius maybe 25. Now for the middle, you can just draw some construction line. I'll click this. In the sketch palette, you can change the line for the center line. Using this option, you can change it to the center line. Using this option, you can make it a construction. For the middle option, first we need to select the object. This is a mirror line. Okay. This way we can mirror the objects. This is a point option. The point is created. Now you can dimension it.
Hello, Sunu.
Sunu, we can't hear you properly.
Once check your mic.
Hello.
Yeah, you're audible.
Yeah, for the circular pattern, select the option circular pattern. Then now select the object. Then we need to specify the center point. For now, I'll select it as a origin. Now number of patterns required. We can edit from here. Four of them. Now the circular pattern is created. Similarly, the rectangular pattern option. I need to select the direction. Right click. For the direction, I need to draw the construction line. Selected the object. Now I need to select the direction. This line. In the distance type, we can select the extent from the first object. Extent means from the first object to the last object. We can also select the spacing. For now, I'll select the spacing. And the quantity. It can change the direction to one direction and symmetric everything here. This is the direction in this. Now the fillet option. Fillet option is used to create a round to reduce the sharp corners. Press the fillet, select the two lines. Now you will get a curved surface. You can adjust the radius of this using this arrow also. Also you can specify by typing the radius manually. Then the offset tool, select object, then you can offset it to the either side. Yeah, this side is also possible. This is offset tool. The trim tool is used to delete the line segments which should be intersected by any edge or something. You can delete like this. Now coming to the constraint. So I'll draw the line like this. Then I can just horizontal or vertical constraint. Now the line is vertical. If I draw a line like this, and that's the horizontal constraint, it will make the line horizontal. If there is a line and the circle, we can make these two tangent by using the tangent option. We can make a two dimensions equal by using the equal constraints. Now the length of the board will be equal. Now the parallel, first we need to select object, then the second object selected will get parallel to this. In the inspect we have like tools to measure. We can measure any entity, let's press this. Now the distance between these two lines will be measured. Coming to the 3D model, here we can extrude, revolve and make a hole, and similar way the circular pattern and the rectangular pattern. And there will be also the option for the press pull, fillet, shell, combine and split body. First I will make a rectangle. Now to make this a 3D, we need to extrude. In the extrude, we can extrude two sides, symmetric, one side, etc. In the extend type, we can select to the object. If some other object is present here, we can, by clicking the two object option, we can extrude till that object. And in the operation, there are like join, cut, intersect, new body and new component. The components are used to make an assembly, and the bodies are the part of the components. The component contains both the body and sketches. For now, There is nobody, so I'll give a new body. Okay. In this way, we will explode any 2D surface. By creating a profile, then we can explode. Here you can hide and unhide the body in the browser. You can also delete the body by right clicking it. I'll hide this one. For the revolve, we need a one line, center line. I'll make this as a construction. Now I'm creating a profile for to revolve. I can select this as axis. Here we can provide an angle as input, or if similar way to the object option is also there, and the full. The angle, you can adjust the angle. For example, maybe 90. You can also edit it by clicking it in the timeline. Edit feature. You can also control using this orbit. For the whole option, we need to select a face and then the reference. In this way, we can create a hole. The press pull, we can extend this surface by using the press pull option. Select the face. We can also specify the distance here, maybe 200. This option is to fillet the edges. We need to select the edges. Then we can specify the radius here. Radius of the fillet, maybe 10. This is the cell option. For the making a cell, we need to select a face. Then thickness, maybe 10. Now the cell is created. to make a web file, I need to draw the lines in this. So I'll create a line by selecting this plane. To project these edges to the sketch plane, we can use project option, project, select these edges. Move the back. We need to select a curve. This one. This one. You can adjust the thickness here. In the depth option, you can specify the depth up to next. This is the option to the flip direction. Now I need to split this body, so I'm taking a construction plane. From this, now to split body, first we need to select the body to split. Then the split chain tool. We can also select from the browser. Now we have multiple bodies. The body is split along this plane. We can combine the body. We can also combine the bodies. First, we need to select a target body, then the next body. Here there is also the option to join, cut and intersect. One more join. You can also create a new component by checking this. This is the option to move, copy. You can set pivot at any point. Just done. You can move in any direction, also any axis. the sweep, we can sweep some profile throughout the line, throughout any line or a curve. So I am taking a line. Now in this plane, I'll create a sweep profile. Now select a sweep. I'll select the profile. This one. And the path. This way you can sweep any profile. In the path dimension. There is also the option to give a taper angle, twist angle, and you can change the orientation. Yeah. Coming to the rig. Now to make the rib between these two surfaces, I need to draw a profile here. To make a rib, select curve. I can flip direction here. In the symmetric, we can make it one direction or symmetric. There is also option to the depth, or you can specify the depth. This is the rib feature. There also option for the some primitive shapes like box, cylinder, sphere, torus, coil, pipe. For the book, just select the thing. You can just create a box by drawing a profile and specifying the height. Similar way in the cylinder. Look at this is the option for the look at. You can see in the diameter of the cylinder here. It is 75. The operation same join, cut, intersect, new component option. Same way in the sphere, we need to specify the diameter of the sphere. Now can you try this model? I'll share this model in the chat itself. Hello. Yeah, I shared a model in the chat.
Guys, juniors, can you please check if you can access the chat box?
No.
Okay, so I'll share this model with the through the Google groups, and now Guhan will proceed with the session.
Hello everyone, good evening. Am I audible?
Yeah,
cool. Yeah, good evening. I am Guhan, a third year mechanical engineering student. I'll be talking mainly about the assembly modeling and certain other high level features of Fusion 360. So I'll just share my screen. Yeah, so can anyone confirm whether my screen is visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, this is my introduction. So the first thing, first slide over here is about importing designs. So here there's a four-step procedure. I would be demoing it right now, so no need to read through it. And coming to assembly modeling. So as Shunu already explained, you would be using various features such as extrude, revolve, sketches, etc. to create various bodies and various components in your design. But once you have created these components, they need to be put together in a logical sequence, in a logical manner to get a meaningful product finally. So that is the main idea behind the assembly modeling. So first of all, and this assembly modeling involves various types of joints. I guess most of you would be familiar with different types of joints like slider joint, revolute joint, etc. So these joints can be created using components and they cannot be created using bodies. So this we do not need to dive into depth about what's the difference between components and bodies and all, but then for a basic understanding you can just assume that a component is a collection of bodies. A component can consist only of a single body or it can consist of multiple bodies as well. And components are the ones that are used in the assemblies. So I would show you, like I guess Shunu already mentioned, but I would also be showing you how to create components from bodies. And in Fusion 360, you have basically seven types of joints, and each of these joints will be having different types of relative motion between the two components involved. So the different types of joints are rigid joint, slider joint, revolute joint, cylindrical joint, pin slot joint, planar joint, and ball joint. So I would start with the universal joint assembly right now. So before that, I need to import certain components from certain other designs. So the import option is basically available for you if you want to borrow your current design from something that you have already designed or from something that you have already worked on previously designed. So for that, you need to first of all, you need to create a new design file and you need to have this design file saved. So currently my design file is saved. So and then I would be borrowing my Fusion 360, my universal joint model from this universal joint folder. So I have already modeled a certain the fork and all. So you just need to select the body or the design file that you want to import into your current design. Right click on this particular design file and then you just need to click on insert into current design. So it would just take some time to be imported, and by default it will be inserted into the origin of your current design file. And you can just click on OK since this is the first object. And these components I've already designed and kept it in a separate file. You just need to use the extrude, revolve, and other 3D modeling options that Shunu has already spoken about to create these different types of bodies. I would just be speaking about how to assemble these together. So now the universal joint makes use of two forks. So I would be inserting the fork again into my model to get the second fork. So as you can see, by default, the fork, the second fork also will be inserted at the origin itself. So I just basically both the forks have been overlapped right now. So I just need to move the second fork and separate it out from the first one to so that you can see that there are two forks. And then there is something called a center block in the universal joint. So I'm inserting that as well into my current design. So again, I'll move it into some random position. You can just move it into some random position for the time being. So I close it temporarily. And then now I will assembling it. So by default, whenever you insert something, some other design file into your current design file, each of these bodies will be inserted as components itself. You do not need to explicitly convert them into components. So I can directly go for the joint option. So in my joint option here, I'm not going to provide any motion right now. This I'm showing this universal joint assembly mainly to speak about the fixed joint. So I'll go to the type of motion. So once you click, I'll just redo this. So here you have the joint option under the solid tab in the assemble panel. So click on joint. And then you have two tabs over here in the dialog box that opens. So one is position and the other one is motion. So first I'll just finish off with the motion. So it's just going to be rigid joint right now. There's not going to be any relative motion. And I just need to select two components. First of all, I will select the before doing that, I'll just give you an idea about how I'm going to proceed with this. So here you can see, I'll go to the top view. And here you can see that there is there's a top surface for this particular center block. And the top surface of this particular center block should coincide with the bottom surface. I'll just hide this particular body currently. Okay. So I'm gonna first of all join these two components. So I want this top surface of the center block to be coinciding with you can see the highlighted part of the fork over here, right? The highlighted surface of the fork. So I want this highlighted surface of the fork to be coinciding with the top surface of the center block over here. So I'm gonna use the joint option to perform this. So initially I select the first component. And so I've chosen the first component over here, and now I need to select the second component. So I would be selecting the second component over here. And if you see here, the center block has been moved from its original position to the position that I have specified. But then if you see the cavity in the center block over here towards the other end, it is being blocked by the solid portion of the fork. So, but then that shouldn't happen because we would be inserting a shaft through this portion of the as a center block, and hence we just need to rotate the center block by a bit so that the cavity parts opens up like this on either side. So now you can see that there is a complete gap through it such that the cavity is open on either side, and we can insert a shaft or a pin, whatever we want, into this particular cavity. So now I'm coming to the angle by which you rotate. It depends on your design decision. So universal joint is generally used to transmit rotary motion between shafts that are at intersecting or that are inclined to one another. And hence it depends on your design decision and your application for which you're using. So you can either give it a 45 degree angle, 30 degree angle, etc., depending on your application. So just for the timing, I'll just be using the 50 degree thing. And then if you remember, I had hidden the other other folks, so I will be unhiding it right now. And then so I just need to get this second fork to coincide with this particular portion of the center block that is being highlighted right now. So to do so, I will again make use of the joint option over here. It is by default, since I've used the rigid motion option previously, it is by default selected. So I would be selecting the components for which I need to components that need to be joined together. So this and this. So now coming to this, if you can see the second fork that is there, it is present at the outside of the center block. So what I want to do here is I want to have this particular, I will just highlight it, I guess. Okay, I just want to have this left side portion of the fork coming on to the other side of the center block, because one portion of my fork is in contact with the center block. I want the other portion of the fork to be in contact with the center block on the other side. So to do so, I will be making use of the flip option. So once I do the flip option, immediately my fork comes, either end of my fork is in contact with either end of my center block. And similarly, for the other fork as well, the either end of the other fork is in contact with either end of the vertical portion of the center block. So this is about inserting the center block. And then I would also show another extension of it. So here we have the pin. So pin is also an integral component of the universal joint. I'm just inserting the pin as I had done for the other components previously. So we will be making use of two pins in our design, and hence I'm inserting two pins into the design currently, just randomly positioning it now. So again, this would again be a fixed rigid motion. So again, I would be selecting. Now the thing is, you can see the circular portion of the pin that is being highlighted, right? So this circular portion of the pin that is being highlighted should coincide with the circular portion that is being highlighted right now. So basically, if you see from top, there is there's a cavity going through this fork, through the body of the fork. So I just want to insert this particular pin into this hole. So again, I repeat, this particular section, the circular perimeter in the pin that is being highlighted should coincide with the circular perimeter in the fork that is being highlighted currently. So for that, I'll be making use of the joint option again. So if I select this and this, again, my pin gets inserted this way, but then my pin is there on top. So I need to flip it so that my pin gets inserted into the other direction. So I would be doing the same thing for the other pin and the other fork as well. So again, this time.
Is it only me or his screen is stuck for everyone?
No, I can switch for available from me. It's not stuck.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, can I cut
again? Yeah, you can.
Cool. Okay. So again, if you see over here, the pin is protruding out. So I do not want the pin to protrude out. It needs to be passing through the fork over here. So again, I'll click on the flip option. So my pin gets inserted into the fork. And this is how my universal joint, it's a basic universal joint. So that is ready. So this is about the rigid joint between multiple components. And I would be moving ahead. So this is the universal joint assembly that I created right now. Now I would be talking about the slider joint. And coming to the slider joint, I'll just be creating some simple components over here to that I can use for creating the joint. So first of all, I'll create a cylinder. So for creating the cylinder, I'll make a circle of diameter 5 mm. And yeah. So now, as you can see, the sketch is black in color, so it's completely constrained. So I'll finish the sketch and I will extrude this particular circle. Say I'll give it a double side extrusion. So this would go for say 25 mm. So you can just give 25. So basically now I have a cylinder whose height is 50 mm, so 25 mm above the origin and 25 mm below the origin, and its diameter is 5 mm right now. So I'll be creating another sketch. So I'll just hide this body for the time being. So now I'll create another sketch in that the inner diameter will be equal to 5 mm. And let us say the outer diameter is 10 mm. So again, the sketch is fully constrained and I'll be extruding it right now. So I'll select the profile that needs to be extruded. So basically my idea is I'll just create a hollow cavity like this, and inside that hollow cavity, the original cylinder that I prepared initially, that will be inserted inside. So here, let us say it's, again, I'll make it a double side extrusion. So here 10 mm down in the downward direction and 10 mm in the upward direction. So now I have two bodies over here, but as I mentioned earlier, you can create joints only between components and not between bodies. So how to convert this these two bodies into components? So just select the body from the browser over here, right click on the body, and then you can go to the third option that comes up, that is create components from bodies. The moment you click on this, the body 3 gets eliminated from the bodies section and it goes into the component 3 of 1. So it is a component right now. I'll do the same thing with the other body as well. So now I will be, so basically in my slider joint, it allows motion only in one direction. So currently I will be, my aim is to make this particular cylinder move up and down inside the this second component. It should move up and down in the Z direction. So for that, I will first fix the position of the second component. So I'll be grounding it. So once you ground it, you cannot move this particular component, but then you can move the other component. So I'll just undo the selection and then go to the joint option, but this time I require the slider joint. So I'll under the motion tab, I'll select slider, and then coming to the components, I'll select this component. And again, now in the second component, I'll be selecting the outer component. So this way, as you could see, this inner cylinder was moving up and down. So I'll again, so now once you have created this joint, it will be present under the joints folder. So there's a slider joint over here. So you can right click on this and you can put edit joint limits. So in reality, you will be creating certain mechanisms where there will be certain endpoints or there will be certain extreme positions for the mechanism. So those extreme positions can be implemented using these joint limits. So going ahead, let me say I'll give a minimum of 10 mm. Okay, or let me make it 20. So minimum of 20, and then I'll give you a maximum limit of 20. So minus 20 and positive 20 are my maximum limits. So this way I have given the joint limits right now. And if I try to move my the inner cylinder more than 20 mm, it doesn't move actually. So even if I try to move it downwards now, it doesn't move more than a position of minus 20 mm because I have given the constraint using the joint limits. So it only moves between the lower extreme and the upper extreme limits. So this is about the slider joint. And then coming to the threading part, I would also like to show the threading option. So here, let me just hide this component. So you just have a simple option over here called as thread under the create panel. So you can just choose the surface on which you need to provide the threading. And then you have this, so you can get a visual view of how the thread would look. And then once you click on modeled, immediately the thread would appear onto the surface that you have selected. And then here you have a drop down about different threads that you would want to use. There are different types of threads which you'll be learning in college. So, and then you can just click on OK. So you'll be getting the thread. So this is one way, one easy way of getting the threads. So that is about the slider joint and threading. So now coming to the planar joint, again, planar joint is another different type of joint where you'll be having the translating motion in X and Y axis directions, that is along two axis, and the rotation about the third axis. So say rotation about the Z axis. So you can, again, you can use the same type of thing that I did over here. So once you click on the joint option, you'll be getting a planar motion over here. And then you can go to edit joint limits and edit like the limits in which you want to do the you want to set the limits for X axis, Y axis, etc. So you could try it as a self learning experience for the planar joint. Just create like two bodies, two extruded bodies, two extruded boxes, whatever it is, and then you can apply planar joint. And then I'll move on to the gears, and I'll talk about the revolute joint mainly. So now, yeah, so how to introduce gears. So before I, so gears can be introduced using something called as scripts or add-ins. So these are basically certain programs written in C++, Python, etc., which would generate your components. You do not need to explicitly perform all the extrude, revolve, and all the other operations to carry out the design process. So before doing the introducing the add-in into my design, I'll have to create certain sketches so that I can use the sketch as reference to position my gears in the appropriate location. So first, let me say I'll create a circle of 32 mm diameter, and then I'll create another circle of 20 mm diameter. So now I want this, so these circles are essentially the pitch circles of the gears, which you'll be learning in your machinery design course. So I'll create a tangent constraint between these two circles, but then though I have created a tangent constraint, my circle is free to move along the circumference of the first circle, the fully constrained circle. So to avoid that, I will be using the horizontal vertical constraint as well. So now the centers of these two circles is in the same horizontal line, and the design is fully constrained. So I'll just add another circle over here for a diameter of 10 mm. And again, I'll use the same constraints again. Yeah. So this completes my sketch. So now I will be going on to the go to the tools tab, and under the tools tab, I have different panels over here, and I'll go into the add-ins dropdown, and under the add-ins dropdown, I'll be selecting scripts and add-ins. So under scripts and add-ins, I'll be there are a lot of, so you can see Python scripts over here, and this blue color thing is a C++ script. So I'll be choosing a spur gear. Python script is generally used, so I'll be choosing a spur gear Python script, and you need to make all the gear specifications over here. So I'll be making the gear specifications, and see, I'll give a hole diameter of 10 mm. So once I click on OK, my gear will be inserted right now. Okay, I'm sorry. Just a minute. Okay, I'm not sure. Okay, the reason why this is happening is I have created the section plane over here for inspection. So that's the reason it's happening. So I'm sorry, I'll just repeat the process again. certain gear specifications that you'll be learning in your course material. So you don't need to worry about what these terms and what these dimensions exactly mean right now. I'm just giving some random dimensions. So yeah, I'll insert my gear. So now you can see my whole gear has been inserted. So now I'll be inserting my second gear as well. As you can see, I've drawn three circles. So I'll be inserting three gears. So all the other dimensions will remain the same. Only the number of teeth in each of these gears will vary. So now you can see, like, there is one gear over here, there is one gear over here. So by default, the gears will be introduced, will be positioned at the origin, such that the center of the gear coincides with the origin. So I'll hide the outer, the bigger gear, so that the second gear that I, the smaller gear that I inserted right now is visible. And now the position of this second gear is the second circle that I have drawn. So I need to position it properly. So for that, I'll go into the solid tab, and under the modify dropdown, I have an option called as align. So under the align option, I will be selecting the current center of the gear, and then I will choose the destination location of the gear. So once I've done, my gear has been shifted right now, and I'll click on capture position. And then click on OK. So my first larger gear is positioned over here, and my second gear is positioned over here. So similarly, I'll be inserting another gear as well. So again, I'll just give five teeth over here. So again, you can see the last gear that I inserted is positioned over here. So again, I'll be making use of the align option and positioning it properly. Click on capture position and select OK. So now I have inserted all three of my gears. So now I would like to provide the meshing option, the meshing behavior between all these three gears. But then, so for the meshing option to happen, the each of the gears must rotate about their center, right? So for that, I would be giving the first. I need to create a revolute joint for each of these gears. So I'll go to the motion tab and click on revolute over here, and then coming to the position. So first, I would be giving it for the first gear here. And so now you can see my first gear rotates. So I'll just click on OK. So then I'll give the revolute joint motion for the second gear as well. So now if you observed in the first, when I provided the motion for the first gear, I clicked on the same center of the gear twice. So now if I'll just show you why I did that. Like, if I do not do it, what exactly will happen? So first I will click on the center of this gear, and then I will click at some random position elsewhere. So if I do that, my gear gets positioned somewhere at some random place and starts rotating at some random location, which is obviously not desired. So to avoid that, I would be, so that is the reason I click on the same location twice. So one of the selections is to select which component you are providing the motion for, and the other, the second method is to show about which position you want the gear to rotate. So this way I've given my motion for the second gear as well. And similarly, I'll follow the same procedure for the third gear as well. Yeah. So now all these three gears have revolute joint or a rotation motion between them. Now I would like to provide the meshing option. So before I give them meshing for the gears or the mating for the gears, so there I'll just rotate the second gear such that the teeth of the second gear lies in between the teeth of the first gear, and there is no overlap between these two gears, the teeth of these two gears. So if I zoom in here, there's no overlap in this location as well, and if I zoom into this location, there is no overlap here as well. So But at the same time, you can observe that there is overlap between these two gears. So at the moment, I'll just leave the overlap between these two gears as it is. So, and I'll capture the position, capture the current position. Now I'll be introducing motion links. So for motion rings, you need to select multiple joints. So first I'll select the revolute joint number one, that is for this, the largest gear over here. And then I'll select the revolute joint number two, that is for the second gear over here. Now you can see that both these gears are rotating in the same direction, but then when two gears undergo mating, one of them will be rotating in the counterclockwise direction and the other one would be rotating in the clockwise direction. So for that, I need to click on reverse over here so that their direction of revolution changes, become opposite to one another. And then coming to the angle, so here if I you can see for revolute one the angle is 360 and revolute two also the angle is 360. So this way you would not, the thing is both these gears will be rotating at the same speed, but then in gears we do not want the both the gears to rotate at the same speed, they need to be rotating at different speeds. So here I would be selecting giving the speed as 22.5. So now the reason why I'm giving it as 22.5 is basically it is 360, that is the angle for one complete rotation divided by the number of teeth. So 360 divided by 16 gives me 22.5. The number of teeth in the larger gear is 16. And similarly, I'll do the same thing. The number of teeth in the second gear is 10. So I'll be doing 360 divided by 10, which gives me 36 degrees. Here I am putting 22.5 degrees and here 36 degrees. So now you can see that there is a perfect mating between, a smooth mating between the larger gear and the second gear. So I'll click on OK. Now I'll be doing the same thing. I'll be inserting another motion link between the second revolute joint and the third revolute joint, that is between these two gears. So again, 360 divided by number of teeth, that is 10, gives me 36. And the number of teeth in this third gear is 5. So 360 divided by 5 gives me 72. Again, you can see the second and third gear are rotating in the same direction. So I'll click on reverse again to reverse, to make the direction of rotation opposite to one another. So then I'll click on OK. So now I'll be showing something called as, so now again, once you click on a particular joint over here, I mean, once you right click on a joint, so you'll be getting these different options. So now here you can see there are two options over here, animate joint and animate model. So I'll just perform animate joint over here. And then you can see only my first revolute joint keeps on rotating, but my other two gears, nothing is happening to them. So that I can just press escape over here to stop the animation. And then again, let me click on the, right click again, and now I'll click on animate model. So the moment I put animate model, all three of my gears are rotating. Basically my entire system is working. So basically the difference between animate joint and animate model is that your animate joint consists of considers only one joint, the joint that you have selected, but your animate model consists of considers all the other joints and the motion links as well. So that is the difference between these two options. Now, I would also like to show you something, some other inspection techniques. So here, as I showed you earlier, there's no overlap between the teeth of these two gears, but there is overlap between the teeth of these two gears. So let me go to the inspect dropdown over here and select interference. So under interference, let me choose these two gears and then I'll just click on compute. So it says me that it gives me the message that no interference is detected. But at the same time, if I perform the same interference analysis for the second and the third gear and I click on compute, then immediately I get some volume of interference that is present. So again, you do not need to worry about what interference is. You'll be learning about it in your course. So the reason why I left it, why I left an overlap between these two gears intentionally was to show that how to perform the interference analysis. So and then, so these are the screenshots of what I've done just now. And I've spoken about animate joint and animate model as well. So now moving on to certain other things that you have something called as a McMaster car components. So now McMaster car is basically an American company that provides various standard hardware components for you. So you can go into the insert drop down over here and you have an option over here saying insert McMaster car component. So once you do that, there will be a dialog box that opens. So this is basically like a smaller version of the McMaster car components website itself. So here you have a different categories of hardware tools or the objects that you would want. So I would go for fastening and joining. So under fastening and joining, I have various nuts, screws, etc. So I just click on screws and bolts. So here you can choose the system of measurement that we use. So in generally in UK and the European countries, they'll be using the inch as the system of measurement. Whereas in India, we use the metric system of measurement. So I just go for metric, and you can select what other different type of different specifications for this bolt or the nut that you want. So I just randomly select M8 over here. And similarly, I'll just randomly select these options. Again, just for the demo purpose, I'm randomly selecting these things. You can, based on your design decisions and based on your application, you will be making an intelligent decision about what exactly should be the pitch, the diameter, etc., etc. So these are certain things. And once you select all the specifications, then you can see here you have an option to order these components from the McMaster car. But then I'm not obviously going to order things right now. So here I'll go click on product detail, the yellow color that is being highlighted. So once I click on product detail, so here there is a drop down and a download option over here. So this is not for SolidWorks software. The 3D SolidWorks would connect it to the SolidWorks software, but then I am not using SolidWorks right now. So I'll be using 3D Step. So again, these are different types of different extensions or different ways in which your file or the design is being encoded, like how you have the TXT and PDF format, etc. So similarly, you have for design files, you have STEP and various other formats, IGS, IGES, etc. So once I select the format over here, then once I click on download, it'll just take some time to get downloaded, and my component has been inserted right now. So I'll just position it in the desired location. At the moment, I'm positioning it randomly, and then I'll click on OK. So the advantage with this introducing this McMaster car component is that you do not need to separately perform all your extrude, revolve, the threading operations, etc., and invest time in creating all the complex threading and complex designs here. You can just directly insert your standard hardware devices or hardware components into your design easily. And in generally also in the industry, once you go into the industry, you'll be using all the standard hardware components, and you will not be designing certain common things like nuts, bolts, etc. very regularly. So you'll be using some standard nuts and bolts. So such standard components can be introduced using the McMaster car components. And then coming to inspection techniques, so Shunu already spoke about the measure, and I've already spoken about the interference for the gears. And then there is something called as section analysis. So before going to section analysis, I'll show something called as component color cycling toggle. So here under the inspect dropdown, the last option is component color cycling toggle. So if you click this, then what will happen is each of your components will be colored in different shades, and hence you'll be able to identify each of your components separately. And this will help you in studying different types of motions and studying complex designs where you have very small components and very components in the having very small dimensions. So you can again switch it off. If you do not want, you can again click it and switch it off. So this is about component color cycling toggle. And then you have something called as the timeline over here. You can just shift this vertical bar over here, and you can go back to any previous version of your design. So if you want to if you want to refer to this design for some other product or for something else in the future, or you want to identify the steps that you followed to create this design so that you can improvise it, or you can you want to refer it for some other reason for creating some manual, etc., etc. So then you can go you can refer to this design process step by step by navigating along this design timeline, and you can check out the different stages of your design. So that is one thing. And then coming to the other inspection technique that I was talking about, that is about the section analysis. So basically, section analysis helps you to identify or helps you to determine the cross section of a particular of a component. So once I click on section analysis over here, you need to select some plane over which the section analysis will be done. So I'll be selecting this plane randomly for the time being. So the moment I do this and click on OK, so here, this is my section, this is my cross section over here. And so now if I rotate this gear, you can see how the cross section in this particular plane varies. I hope you guys can see the variation in the area of the purple patch as I rotate the gear manually. So This way you can study various other things like how the cross section varies and how, so because you need to know how the cross section varies in a particular plane or how the cross section is affected, because ultimately you'll be dealing with stresses and other things which depends on the area. So this helps in getting the shape of the cross section as well as the cross sectional area. So this is about the sectional analysis. And then, yeah, so I have already spoken about the timeline as well. And if you want to learn more about Fusion 360, there is a detailed guide. And this is basically the official link from the Autodesk company itself. So maybe, I guess this PDF might be circulated, I'm not sure. So yeah, I'll just share the link with you guys over here. I mean, yeah, so I'll share it in the chat later on. So this is about the KAP part from my side. So do you guys have any other questions regarding this? Yeah, hello, am I audible?
Yes.
You guys have any doubts?
I guess no one has doubts, so we can wrap up the session. Guhan, you want to conclude?
Yeah. So yeah, first of all, I would like to thank all of you for attending this KAP. And if you guys have missed out on anything, or if you haven't understood something clearly, you can. We would be uploading the recording of this session in YouTube, and we would be sharing the YouTube link in all our social media handles, and we would be circulating it through the Google group as well. So you can refer to that link, and you can. You can learn more about the software. And if you have any more doubts, you can contact me or Shunu personally. So I guess our contact numbers were circulated with the spam messages. So you can definitely contact us, and we would be definitely happy to help you guys out. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Guhan. And thank you to all of you for attending this KAP. And you can leave now. The recordings and materials will be put up in the dry link or YouTube channel, which will be shared with you guys later.
Thank you all.